Okay, the third static correction method, which is the refraction static, can be corrected by using the delay time, the GRM, the generalized reset quantum method, or DRM, the Malaysian residual matrix. Basically, the last two, all three mentioned over here was taught in the transmit method techniques. So I will not repeat these three methods again. Now just to recap back, the critical angle, how does the refraction came in? Okay, refraction came in due to the incident angle, and then the refracted angle at the critical angle, which is 90 degrees. And then you need to find out the value alpha c, which can be found out by using this formula, Snell's law. Okay, very basic. Okay, the refraction method techniques, as a continuity, you can find out the slope of direct arrival 1 over V0, slope of the refraction arrival 1 over V1, and the intercept time. This is just a recap back from your seismic method class. Okay, it's very straightforward. How to find out the value from your refraction, the velocity value. From the velocity value, you should be able to calculate the static straightforward. Okay, first arrival, the direct arrival from the source to the geophone will give you the velocity. First refraction will give you the velocity of the V1. Second refraction will give you the velocity of V2. So if you find out the slope for that level, first refraction and second refraction will give you the velocity of the V0, V1 and V2 correspondingly. Right? In the seismic data processing in the real industry, how we do the static correction? First we pick the refraction. Okay, as we mentioned in the first figure over here, repeat the refraction. Okay, plot the peaks, indicate here by the red dot. Okay, and then fit the straight line, and then determine the refractor velocity and the thickness. Okay, you can calculate the velocity and the thickness from this refraction lines. Okay, the thickness is basically the intercept. The velocity is the gradient of the graph. Right, this is very important. Somehow, if you in the later stage when we learn about diving wave tomography, one of the techniques to improve the imaging, you need to pick the refraction as been mentioned over here. Right, first break peaks. Okay, basically, in the seismic data processing, you need to pick the first break. Okay, in order to remove the static, also apply for DWT techniques, diving wave tomography. This is the example, near surface model from the refraction. Okay, once you pick the first break, in other words, you pick the refraction, you should be able to create the model. Okay, from here, after you pick, then you can create the model, which will give you the model of the near surface. And the near surface indicate that the area just beneath the surface level. This is the example of the static correction. This is after A is the CFP gathers. After you do the linear move out, okay, you will see some discontinuity. Once you apply the refraction static, then you can see that everything has been flattened out compared to this one. So you have some bumpy, right? Here you have a flat. Okay, you remove all the statics. Now we go to the residual static. Residual static is basically shifting the separated traces to obtain the optimal reflection. Okay, previously we do the static correction in a box. Now we do the static correction for a particular traces. Okay, and this to ensure the traces of single CMP are not shifted randomly. The shift is divided in a value for the source and the receiver. So we do the static correction separately. For each source and receiver, a value is determined. All traces with a certain source are corrected with the value for that source. Similarly, all traces with a certain receiver are corrected with the value for that receiver. With the resulting shift, which is the static correction of a trace, consists of the correction value of the source and the receiver of the corresponding trace. How we do the receiver static correction? This is the flow chart. Okay, first after you do the general static correction here, we do the velocity analysis. You apply the NMO to the gathers, and then you can compute the residual static. Okay, once you compute, you apply, and then you do the velocity analysis again, NMO again, compute residual static, and apply. Okay, this become a iterations in order for you to minimum to have a the best residual static information as possible. We do in the iteration. Okay. This is an example. Let's say you build a model. Step one, you build a model traced by summing all traces from several move-up correlated CDPs. You have the model trace. Step two, you measure trace shift by cross correlate with the model. Okay, the model you create over here, which is over here. You do a cross correlation of the trace, this which is taken from here. You do a cross correlation with this model trace. Okay, for this model trace, after you do the cross correlation, you find out the correspondent value, and then you apply the value to shifted the original trace. Therefore, you become at step 3, and you compute the surface consistent static from trace shift, and then apply to the trace to align the events. Now, after you apply the static value that was produced from this cross correlation, after you apply, you can see the alignment of your events. This is an example in terms of the stack section before residual static and after residual static. Before residual static, basically, you can see it's a lot of discontinuity, like a blur picture. But once you apply residual static, now all the events become continuous. You can see clearly from the image on the right hand side. This example show you a stack section with only general static after, and then the next one after general with the residual static. Okay, if you compare before and after, okay, nothing much you can see, nothing much. This not produce a major improvement, but on the right hand side over here, you can see that it been the event continuity has been improved a little bit. Okay, you need to remember in sensitive data processing, if you're able to improve only a minor, if you can produce a minor improvement to your seismic data, it basically considered a good achievement. Alright. Another example has been indicated by the dotted circle over here. However, how as a young geophysicist, how we can what is the tips to find the static easily? Okay, first one, if you see any abrupt or suspicious vertical alignment, okay, suddenly it's disrupted over here, then that basically they need to apply a statics. In this case, it's a bulk shift or structure common to all reflection events. Okay, such of shallow reflector repeated in deeper events, is that you need to apply a general static as well. Poor reflection quality may be due to improper static correction. Okay, bad static correction mean bad velocities and bad stacking. Changes in near surface topography will cause static problems. Okay, so summary, static are near surface conditions that affect the travel times and amplitude of subsurface reflector. Okay, if you want to have a good seismic interpretation, basically you need to improve or you need to remove all the static problem first. You need to solve the static problem first. Without proper static correction, seismic data may have a poor reflection quality. The subsurface anomalies can be caused by near surface effects. Static correction may hamper velocity analysis and slow data processing because you will have a lot of problem if you don't correct for the static. And two kind of the static problem, long period and short period. Long period can be solved by using the general static solution, while the short period can be solved by using the residual static correction. Okay, I think that's all for the static correction. Hopefully you can understand the static correction techniques been applied in seismic data processing is very crucial in the subsequent seismic data processing techniques. Alright? Okay, thank you very much and see you next time.